morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great privilege for me to have a presentation about environmental risk or disasters. You know that I am usually participating in the summer school. You know that, as you know, that this is the 25th summer school in Kőszeg, and I will speak about a topic which is quite interesting and challenging us very much. The title of my presentation is Risk Perception and Cultural Rationality. Well, you can see that I am emeritus professor of Corvinus University, and today, as an environmental economist, I will highlight some of the issues related to the risk, which is quite interesting phenomenon today. So let me start my presentation. You know that when we are speaking about risk, very rare we are thinking about a kind of risk which is the so-called black swan. You know that this is the idea of Nassim Taleb. You know that he wrote a beautiful book. And there are some risk which is very rare, which is unpredictable, unexpected events. But if it happens, produce a mass effect. And later on, we think so that we can explain it. So the likelihood is very low. We cannot calculate with a mathematical formula. But when it is happened already, you know that we think so that we could predict it. So this kind of black swan, you know that, like the Google, which is a positive black swan, nobody knows, you know, that how the Google will revolutionize the information society, or the tragedy of the September 11th in 2001. And I wonder whether the pandemic, the COVID-19, is it a black swan or not? If you look at the numbers and figures, you know that it's quite interesting that nobody really expected it can happen. And if you look, it is coming from China, you know that, look the dates, you know that 2020 of March, you know that in China, you know that more than 3,000 people died, in Italy more than 6,000 people died. But among the first 10 countries, you know that we can find United States and others. But if we are moving ahead, you know that with the statistics, you know that in May 25, you know that the United States is the first, Brazil is the second, and China somehow disappeared from the list. And in June 22, this is the latest what I could achieve, and I am having the lecture, you know that you look through the numbers, you know that, and again, China is disappeared from the list. So the pandemic rooted in China, you know that, but among the 10 countries, you know that China has disappeared in June. It doesn't mean that there are no viruses there, but unfortunately, many other regions were infected more and more. And if you look two small cartoons, you know that in this slide, you know that interestingly, the countries who are small countries were able to beat the COVID-19, and big countries were not able to do that. So when we are speaking about, you know, that the black swan, I would like to highlight that unfortunately, we could expect it, but I'm saying it today, not half a year ago. We could expect it if the very high population density, very big countries, the globalization can create this phenomena like the pandemia is going on. And interestingly, the small countries, because they were able to isolate themselves from the others, they were able to isolate themselves from the globalization, you know that. They were fighting more successfully with the pandemic than the big countries. And certainly for the future, we have a big questions, you know, that whether what shall we do? You know, that we are the different pharmaceutical companies are competing with each other, who will discover, you know, that the vaccines against the virus. But you see that there is a message for us, you know, that it would be good to think about the lives of the people instead of the profit. So that whether can we allow to the pharmaceutical corporations to compete with each other, you know, that meanwhile a lot of people are hurted by this pandemic, you know, that, and especially the countries like in Africa, they are totally vulnerable and they cannot able to protect themselves against these kind of things. So this is the so-called Black Swan phenomenon, which is very rare, you know, that, but if it is happening, it will influence, you know, that unpredictable, unexpected events. But it will produce a mass effect, you know, that, and later on we think so that we could be prepared for it. One kind of preparation, you know, that we would need to have smaller states, not so big urban areas as we have today, you know, that if you have a city with about 20 million people, you cannot protect them against the pandemic like that. But today I basically would like to speak about not Black Swan, I would like to speak about the environmental risk, which is basically a mass phenomenon. You see that the Black Swan create a mass influence, but the mass phenomenon means that we can calculate the likelihood, the probability of these things, you know, that. And if you look, we can ask whether today the world is more dangerous than used to be, the risk is bigger than used to be a couple of decades ago, or just we have more information, so we are better informed, you know, that what is the situation. If you look at the statistics, you know that. So we are able to make statistics for the mass phenomena. We are not able to make statistics for the Black Swan, because the Black Swan is very rare. So it means that it happens, you know, that once or twice, you know, that we cannot not create a statistics for that. But we can make a statistics, for example, for meteorological events, you know, that hydrological events, or even we can make for earthquake and things like that. So if you look, you know that this is the number, how many times it happens, you know that. And if you saw the numbers are growing. Some people would say that basically because of the climate change, you know that the events, we have more and more events. The graph down here, you know, that shows the, if you look, for example, the earthquake, I cannot say that we have more earthquake today than we used to have. You know that we cannot not make a forecast for the earthquake. We can say nothing about the likelihood of the earthquake. It can happen. We know some parts of the world which is more often, but sometimes, you know, that it happens even in Hungary. But you see that this is a distribution of the earthquake, you know, that is unusual. You cannot say that it's coming back, you know, that, and if it is not an earthquake in a couple of years, then it should be again, you know, that, but not, we don't have more earthquake today than we used to have before. It seems that we have much more weather-related, you know, that catastrophes, and here we are calculating, you know, that the damage done by the catastrophes. So it's interestingly, you know, that I can say that the likelihood of the catastrophes is not necessarily bigger, but the damage done by the catastrophes is bigger and bigger. It basically, because we have more people today than we used to have in 1970, we accumulated, you know, that a lot of things. We have a infrastructure which is much bigger, you know, that today than used to be 50 years ago. So if today we have a flood, you know, that it can create a bigger damage than it could could create 50 years ago. So basically, not necessarily because we have more flood, for example, in Bangladesh than we used to have 50 years ago, but because more people are living there, you know, that the damage is bigger today. So you see here some weather-created damages. You see here the forest fire in Australia. So basically, you know that when we are dealing as a scientist with the risk, you know that the risk is a expected loss or damage associated with the occurrence of a harmful event. And there is a formula, you know that. You know, this is, you know, that the risk depends on the time, depends on the probability, and depends on the damage done. But all of them depending on the time. But the calculation shows, you know, that the RT is product PT and DT, which means that looks a mathematical formula, you know, that we can calculate. As I mentioned, we are trying to reduce the probability. We are trying to avoid, you know, that then something could happen. And sometimes we are trying to avoid the damage done by an event. So if we have a flood in the US or in a rich country, you know that we can keep the people from the flood because we can evacuate them. You know that we have the necessary infrastructure, we have the necessary tools to help them. If a flood happens in Bangladesh, then the people are poor. You know that it can happen that 20,000 people die. A normal hurricane in the United States will kill, you know, that a few people. A similar hurricane in a underdeveloped country, you know, that can kill much more people because they are more vulnerable. They are not able to protect themselves against these kind of hazards. So you see that a lot of things with rationality. Mathematics, you know, that is science, is a very rational subject. You know that here is the formula. You can see that I can calculate the risk. You know that, and I told you that this is a mass event. You know that, and we can calculate the probability. We can calculate the risk, and we can have an insurance against the risk. We cannot have an insurance against the black swan kind of risk because we cannot calculate. Nobody will make you an insurance for something which is not predictable. The other kind of risk what I am speaking about, you know, that is predictable. We have statistics, you know, that how often we have a flood, for example, at the Danube, you know, that, and we can build a dam against it, you know, that, and sometimes we are saying that the dam is protect us against the flood, you know, that which could happen in 2000 year time, you know, that the biggest ever had, you know, that we try to protect ourselves against that. Certainly it doesn't mean that we are fully protected, because sometimes the nature is interesting, can create a bigger flood, but basically we can calculate how big the likelihood of the flood, you know, that, and how we can reduce the damage. I have to categorize, you know, that the risk we can categorize, you know, that basically according to the voluntariness and the fairness of the risk. So the voluntary means, you know, that then I am taking the risk voluntarily. For example, if somebody is smoking or climbing for the Himalaya, you know that the people are taking the risk voluntarily. So they know quite well, you know, that then. It is a risky. The driver of the former, you know, that the pilot of a Boeing, you know, that or a car, you know, that everybody knows that it has a risk, but they are taking it voluntarily. Sometimes, unfortunately, the risk is not voluntary. So, for example, if I am living near to a company which is producing chemicals, you know, that, and if they have an accident, you know, that the risk is not voluntary for me because I am living there, you know, that, and I am hurted with something for what I have no influence. And we are speaking about the fairness as well, you know, that which means that if somebody is enjoying the direct benefit from the risk, you know, that this is fair. So I am smoking, you know, that I'm taking the risk of the cancer when I will be 50 years old, you know that. And it's fair because I enjoy to smoke. Those who are making money in the company, in the chemical company, you know that, and producing something and getting a salary or getting the profit as the owner, for them, you know that the risk is fair. They have to take the risk that in a normal chemical corporation, you know that every year from about 1,000 people, two will die because of a chemical accident. It's fair. Certainly, you know that I don't want to say that it's good or nice, but it's fair that those who are doing that, those who are working for the fire police, you know that it can happen, you know, that then during their job, they can have an accident. What is unfair, you know, that then somebody is building a waste incinerator beside my flat or house, you know, that and they are making a dirty job, you know, that and creating a mess for the surrounding, you know, that, and the people are not benefiting from the activity of the corporation, but they are harmed by the activity of the corporation. So this is unfair. So when somebody is smoking, you know that, and I am not smoking, but I am living together with him or her, you know that, or I am sharing the office, you know that, with a person who is smoking, this is not a voluntary risk for me. And certainly it's unfair as well. It's interesting, you know that, because we are ready to accept risk easily if it is voluntary, and we are accepting it more if it is fair. And certainly we are not ready to accept the risk which is non-voluntary and unfair. So I would like to climb to the Himalaya, you know that it's a very nice thing. I sacrifice a little bit, you know, that maybe my life. But for the Sherpa, you know that, who has to help me when I am in danger, you know that. Meanwhile, he told me that not to go there because the weather condition is not appropriate. It's not. It's unfair, and it's not voluntary risk for the Sherpa. So it's quite interesting. There is one more dimension which I would like to highlight here. This is we are discounting according to the risk as well. Everybody has heard about discounting, basically about the money when we are putting an investment, you know, that we are, if the money is, I'm getting the money today, you know, that is more valuable than I will get the money 20, 30 years from now. So we are discounting according to the time. The person who is smoking today, you know, that enjoying this activity, you know, that I don't know why, but probably they know, but they are taking a risk which will happen maybe 30 years from now, because they will get the cancer when they are about 50 years old. So a young person is smoking today, you know, that and when he will be 60, or she will be 60 years old, can get the cancer. The benefit which they get today, they enjoy to smoke today, you know, that they over-evaluate this benefit today. Meanwhile, they under-evaluate the risk which is coming 50 years from now. There is a lot of activity like that, you know. So we are producing a lot of things. We are accumulating a lot of chemicals in the environment. We are enjoying the benefit today because everything is cheaper for us, but we are accumulating it for the future. For example, the DDT case, you know, that which used to be used as a pesticide, you know, that at the beginning it helped us to kill all the sex, you know, that, and it protect us against several diseases, but it started to accumulate, you know, that, and it had a harm for the next generations. And we under-evaluate, you know, that because it happened later, so that it is the discounting in time. But we are discounting according to the distance as well. So if there is a flood in Hungary, you know that, just going on these days at the Danube and the Tisza River, you know that we are worrying about it, whether shall we have some effect for people who are living near to the rivers. it sometimes happens, unfortunately, that one, two people are die because of the flood at the Tisza River or the Danube River. When the flood is in Bangladesh, you know that, unfortunately, this is just a news for us, that about 20,000 people died because of the flood in Bangladesh. If the same would happen, you know that in the neighborhood, then we would worry much more, and maybe that we would react. But because it's far away, we are not ready to react. So we are discounting according to the distance as well. And unfortunately, there is a third relation, you know, that we are discounting according to the relations as well. So it's certainly it's a little bit dangerous to speak about it, but as a emeritus professor, you know that in the war of 70, I can tell you that an accident, a bus accident, you know that with retired tourists, you know that which would kill 30 people because of the accident, you know that who are in a touristic trip, you know that is a different phenomena than a school bus which is having 30 kids, you know that, and on the way to the school, you know that they have an accident and the kids are killed by the accident. 30 people die who are retired people, 30 people die who are kids, you know that, and everybody, the society is thinking differently. You know, it's a tragedy when the kids will die, and certainly it's a tragedy when the old people are dying, but it's a different kind of strategy, to be fair. So if somebody in my family, you know, that is a soldier and going to the army, you know, that and the NATO, if I have somebody in the family, I would relate totally differently to the fact that the NATO is going to take care of Afghanistan or some other countries, then if nobody in my family is a soldier. When somebody in my family is a soldier, I'm afraid that if my son is a soldier, I'm afraid that he will be taken there, you know, that and it's a risk for him. So it means that we are discounting. And certainly there is one very big problem, you know, that then I told you that it looks rational, you know, that our decision, but in the reality, this is not really true. So the scientists are calculating the risk rationally, but the public is deciding not rationally. Basically, we call it cultural rationality. I still call it rationality, but the cultural rationality means, you know, that they don't care much about the scientific knowledge. They care much about their expertise, you know, that the public speaking about the issues, you know, that, and if they would think that something is risky, you know, that they will protest against. So today the public, they don't want to have, basically, at least many of them don't want to have an atomic power station. Meanwhile, the scientists are telling you the truth. You know that, and I'm telling you the data that atomic power station is not dangerous. The biggest accident can have that we will not have electricity. But the people having a different knowledge about it, because they have seen, you know, that the case of Chernobyl or Fukushima, and they have realized, you know, that then how many people were hurted, you know, that meanwhile the science would say that it cannot happen, but it happened in Russia and it happened in Fukushima, you know, that different reasons but similar phenomena, you know, that so the people remembering for the history, and based on the history, based on the culture, they are against. The people don't like the risk which is not known yet, it's totally new one. They are afraid. So if you look, for example, the pandemia, which was a totally different phenomena, you know, that meanwhile we had the Spanish flu as well. It was a little bit similar, you know, that according to the affected people. But a lot of people were worrying, especially, you know, that the older generation started to worry about it because it's a cultural approach. And if you look through, you know, that what is the difference between the two, you know, that so this is based on the science and this is based on the culture. And when we are speaking of the culture, you know, that the discountation kind of things are important. So if somebody is your family member, then you are worrying more than if somebody else is affected. So if you don't know anybody in the neighborhood who died because of the virus, you know, then you don't feel to be hurted. But if anybody in your family were hurted by this virus, you know, then you will have a totally different approach. And certainly the problem, you know, that we are calculating the risk. You remember how we calculated it, you know, the probability times the damage done. Here we are estimating, you know, that we assume that it's dangerous. And if the people assume that it's dangerous, it will be dangerous for them. And the decision will be made by them. So that's why, you know, that the people, for example, they don't like incinerator or a waste management site in their backyard, not in my backyard, or there is a lot of locally unacceptable land use, so nobody would like to have a waste incinerator, nobody would like to have any things which can have an effect. Meanwhile, the scientists would tell you that this effect is not really, really dangerous. So the cultural rationality, you know, that which is influencing basically our decisions. And we have to build a bridge between the two. So if we are able to educate the people, you know, if we are able to educate the people, then you know that learning and loving, this is the two things in the life, you know, that which is very important. So we have to learn, and if we are learning, you know, that then we can make a bridge between the cultural rationality and the technical rationality. And certainly the most important feeling is not the greediness, but the love. And if you can say that who you have learned in your life and you have loved, then you can say that you've been happy, and I wish you to be happy, and please enjoy the summer school in Kőszeg. Thank you for your attention. Goodbye.